Hello, everyone. Are you confused by the types of separation pay that are out there and how they might affect you later in life? Well, hang on and I'll explain them to you. Stand by. Hello, everyone. This is DJ, and welcome to another episode of the RC Retirement YouTube channel or podcast if you're listening out there in podcast land. This week, I'm going to talk about some of the types of separation pay that the military uses and what effect they can have on you. Let me just dive right in so that we can get this done. This is going to be a bit of a long episode, so I want to get through it as quickly as possible, so hopefully I don't create a lot of confusion. Don't worry, I will have a lot of resources available for you so that the confusion can be minimized. All right, so let's just jump right in. The military uses now and has used in the past various types of separation pay as a way to encourage members of the active component and sometimes of the reserve component to encourage members to leave service. Sometimes this is done as a force-shaping measure to do things like a reduction of force. Sometimes it is due to medical disqualification. Sometimes it's simply because there's too much of one particular job skill or another. In any case, there are types of money that's used to encourage these people to leave early, and sometimes people aren't quite sure what effects these can have on them. Now, I've got quite a long list of notes here, so if you're watching the video, then please forgive me as I do refer to them quite often. I'm not trying to ignore you. I just want to make sure that I get all of my information right, because this is a lot to try to keep off the top of your head. So anyway, many of these people who receive separation pay usually end up in a reserve component. Not always, but it happens a lot. And several of these people can end up becoming eligible for a reserve retirement. More often than not, they are unprepared for what will happen when they apply for their reserve retirement. And when they start getting that reserve retired pay, they are not really happy with what people like me, as a retirement services officer, then end up telling them. So it's my hope with this episode to resolve some of that lack of information and have people better prepared in the future. And just to be clear, even though there is a particular type of pay that is called separation pay, I'm going to use the term separation pay as a general, generic term for all of the types of buyouts that are used or have been used for service members. This might cause a little bit of confusion initially, but I know you can work through it. I believe that as we go on, this will become clearer for you. Now, for starters, everyone who receives separation pay has to sign some sort of agreement or another stating the terms of receiving that money and what could lead to its eventual recoupment. I would provide a form number or some other example of this contract, but despite my efforts, actually over years, I've been unable to come up with a copy. I've even communicated with people at Defense Finance, and they don't have any such copy. So it's mind-blowing for me. Something in my head says there has to be something in writing as far as these agreements. It just has to exist somewhere, but I have not been able to find it. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it was just a statement in an order, and there was no such written agreement in the first place. But for any of you out there, if you have received separation pay yourself and have such a written agreement and you're willing to share that written contract or that written form or order or whatever it may be, I would greatly appreciate it. Don't worry, before I post it to the website, I will sterilize all the personal information. But just for the sake of everyone else out there, if you have something like this and you're willing to provide it, please do so. Anyway, in my search, the only thing I was able to find was a beneficiary election form for one of these separation pays, the variable separation incentive, or the voluntary separation incentive, sorry. Other than that, I could not really find anything that applied to these separation pays as far as official Department of Defense or even specific branch of service type forms. So we'll just move on. And also, throughout this episode, I'm going to refer several times to the Department of Defense Financial Management Regulation, which is a massive 7,200-page publication with all the rules governing how the Department of Defense manages money. Chapter 7, specifically, is how it handles military pay and retired pay. I'm also going to frequently paraphrase from the Defense Finance website and from federal law, so be prepared. Don't worry, I'll translate anything that's in legalese. That's what I'm here to do. Back to the point I was making earlier. A contract of one form or another is signed at the time of receiving separation pay. It might just be a counseling statement. But if the branch of service did its job properly, it informed the member that there are certain terms to receiving this money. I have, however, counseled a lot of people for whom this was not the case, or at least they say this was not the case. I sometimes wonder if this is the whole truth. Maybe it's a case of people hearing what they want to hear, or maybe they actually weren't told at all. I don't know. Either way, when the member becomes eligible for reserve retirement or other military benefits, certain types of benefits, we bump into federal law and consequences ensue. So let's see what those are. And bottom line, sort of up front, all of these separation pays that I'm going to describe are buyouts of your military benefits and retirement. If you accept separation pay, then your military service is, to use my term, deleted. It is in effect no longer in existence, and you are no longer eligible for any retirement benefits as a result of your service. You might still have GI Bill or a few other things, but things like VA compensation and military retirement are out the window. If you do attempt to receive any military retirement benefits after receiving separation pay, or even if you go to the Veterans Administration and try to get disability compensation from them, you will then likely be obligated to repay the entire amount of separation pay you received. There are a few minor exceptions, but in the case of one individual who comes readily to mind, the amount of recoupment that he faced was close to $250,000. He had a lot of money that he'd received over time. So he was not really prepared for that consequence. Anyway, if you apply for VA compensation, the VA can withhold your entire monthly compensation until you have repaid the separation pay. And I'm going to post here a VA recoupment chart. This chart applies to how much total separation pay will be recouped, not how much will be withheld each month. So be prepared for that. Typically, the entire amount of VA compensation is withheld each month until the amount withheld equals the separation pay. Now, if you apply for military retirement, then the Department of Defense can withhold 40% of your military retirement. In fact, when you apply for military retirement, the form on which you apply Department of Defense Form 2656 even asks you if you received any sort of separation pay, and I'll show an example here. You can see it asks about the various types of separation pay and how much you received. If you are receiving both retired pay and VA compensation, then both the Department of Defense and the Veterans Administration can withhold a portion of your pay until the separation pay has been recouped. So be prepared for that. All right. There are, at least for the sake of this episode, four types of separation pay. There are actually several more, but I'm only going to cover four. One of them was rescinded several years ago, but it is still affecting service members today, those who are becoming eligible for reserve retirement, so I am going to cover it. The others are still in effect. I may miss a detail here or there, but this is not meant to be a comprehensive study of these types of separation pay, just an overview, so please forgive me if I lose an occasional detail. Let's move on. First, we're going to cover readjustment, or sometimes called simply separation pay. Readjustment pay is authorized by Section 1174 of Title 10 of U.S. law and is one of the most common of separation pays used by the military. The requirements for eligibility can be found on, well, I won't give the page numbers here because why? It can be found in the Financial Management Regulation. There is a long list of rules, very long list, and I'm going to give one example of eligibility here. This is not the only case of eligibility, just one that I'm going to throw out there for you to consider. So, here is one person who would be eligible for readjustment or separation pay from active duty. So we have an active duty E6 who has met these qualifications. He has completed at least 6 years of active duty, but less than 20 years. Has a characterization of service of honorable. Is eligible for retention. He can stay in service or could stay in service, but he is being involuntarily separated due to a reduction in force, and he enters into an agreement to serve in a reserve component for a minimum of 3 years. So this person could receive readjustment pay of some sort. You'd have to see the Financial Management Regulation for the other rules out there. Like I said, there's a long list, and in the resources section, I have posted both the complete Financial Management Regulation, as well as a couple of archived versions of Chapter 35 of Volume 7A, which deals with separation pay. Whew. Those are older versions of separation pay rules that were in effect at times that are particularly affecting service members now. So those are posted for your reference. There's also a separate provision for half separation pay, which has its own rules, but I'm not going to go into those. If you wish to see that, then you can look at the Financial Management Regulation yourself. For now, let's move on. So the most recent version of the separation pay rules define computation for separation pay this way. Compute full separation pay at 10% of 12 times the amount of monthly basic pay. So basically, 1 year of active duty base pay times years of service times 10%. Yep. That quote that I put in there didn't make a whole lot of sense, but the formula does. So years of service times 1 year of base pay times 10% equals separation pay. So I'll put a simplified version of that on the screen. And for those of you in podcast land, I'm sorry, I'm going to have a lot of numbers coming up soon, so please follow along. For those eligible for half separation pay, it's the same formula, cut in half. Now, let's put some actual numbers into this and see what comes out. So we'll use that E6 I mentioned a bit earlier as our test dummy and see how things work. So first, we multiply 12 years of service by 1 year of base pay as an E6, and then multiply that by 10%. So the formula would now look like this. 12 times 3,776.70 times 12 times 10%. So that's a mess when you're hearing it in audio form only. So it's 1 year of base pay times 12 years of service times 10%. Now we figure out what a year of base pay would be. That's $45,320.40. So now we have 12 years of service times 45,320 times 10%. Now we multiply the years of base pay times the total years of service. That equals $543,844.80 times 10%. We're almost there. Finally, we take 10% of that huge dollar amount to get our answer. The amount of separation pay is $54,384.48. So our fictional E6 will receive over $54,000 in separation pay. This money is taxable, by the way. It's not a freebie, so he should be prepared for quite a tax hit. Now, what about effects on retired pay or VA compensation? Well, this and all the other separation pays I'm going to mention is a buyout of your military retirement and many other benefits. You will not be eligible for VA compensation or military retirement unless the readjustment pay is recouped in full. Or in the case of VA, it might be a little different, but in the case of Department of Defense, it's typically in full. So now let's move on to the next type of pay. That is the voluntary separation incentive. This one is particularly odd in the view of some people because it's a recurring payment. I actually thought that this type of pay had been rescinded. And it, in a way it has, but my research has proved that there's a different version called voluntary separation pay. That's currently set to expire at the end of this year, but I'm going to talk about the original one, voluntary separation incentive. So anyway, the voluntary separation incentive is an annual payment based on years of active duty service and the member's pay grade. So the rules for the voluntary separation incentive are served at least 6 years of service, of active duty service, but less than 20. Have served at least 5 continuous years of active duty immediately prior to separation. You have not been approved for other types of separation pay. You've requested separation from active duty. And you meet what other requirements have been set by your branch of service. Now, we're getting into more math. Uh-oh, don't worry. So now, the formula for VSI, Voluntary Separation Incentive, is years of service times 1 year of base pay times 2.5%. And that would equal the annual amount of VSI. So I'll add the numbers to this formula again to make it clearer. We're going to use our same E6. So his year of base pay is $45,320.40, and he has 12 years of active duty service. So when we multiply his year of base pay times 12, we get $543,844.80, and 2.5% of that is $13,596.12. I actually shortcut a lot of that for you. If you want to see the exploded version, then you can look at the article that posts on Friday. So for VSI, you actually receive payments for double the number of active duty years that you have. So in this person's case, he would receive this $13,000 payment for 24 years. He had 12 years active duty service, so he would receive VSI for 24 years, as long as he remained in a reserve component of some sort, and that could be the individual ready reserve or the retired reserve, for all that matters. Taxability. VSI is a lump sum payment, and it is fully taxable. And I'm actually going to skip taxability and effects on retired pay and VA compensation for the rest of these, because they're all the same. They're all taxable, and they all must be recouped if you wish to have VA compensation or military retirement. So let's just make that a given and carry on. Okay, everyone, I originally recorded all four types of separation pay and their descriptions all together, but in hindsight, I think that's a lot to absorb, so I'm going to cut this into two pieces. I'm going to have one piece this week and the other piece next week. That way, it's easier to absorb and hopefully won't be as hard on the brain bucket. So it would be a good thing next week if you were to review this week just a bit. In fact, I might just have a reference to it in the introduction for next week, just to be clear. In fact, I'll go ahead and record that now since I'm here. All right, so thank you for being here this week and for being part of this audience, and thank you for learning about separation pays. Please join me next week. Oh, and by the way, if you haven't, see, I always point the wrong way. If you have not already subscribed, please do so right now and join me next week. And if I haven't said it already, thank you for your service. Have a great week.
If you liked what you heard on today's episode, then please go below and give it a thumbs up and be sure to subscribe to this channel. Also, please let other people know about this channel and the information it can provide for them. If you have questions or comments, then have no qualms about posting them in the comments section below. Please remember, the RC Retirement YouTube channel and the RC Retirement website are not recognized or endorsed by the Department of Defense, the Department of Veterans Affairs, or any other government agency. The information presented in these resources are for entertainment and informational purposes only. Also, the content of either of these resources should not be considered financial or legal advice. Please consult with your own legal counsel, accountant, and financial planner before making any decisions based on what you have learned here. As always, thank you for watching the RC Retirement YouTube channel.